everyone, I'm Raymond Francis, and we're continuing with our series to teach you how to get well and how to stay well. For those of you who have not seen one of these before, I'll give you a little bit of background. Everything we do is based on the model of health called the Beyond Health Model that I outlined in my book, Never Be Sick Again. Never Be Sick Again is the fundamental resource for each of you. So if you want to learn how to get well and stay well, read a copy of Never Be Sick Again. In there, we have a revolutionary approach to health and disease called the Beyond Health Model, because what we're trying to do here is to produce something that we can teach to a child, something that anyone can put to use in their life that is simple enough to put to use and yet powerful enough to prevent and reverse almost all disease. And that's what the Beyond Health Model is all about. And we've reduced it, we've simplified it down to where there's only one disease. There are not thousands of diseases, there's just one. And here's what it is: it's a malfunctioning cell. You see, we're all made of these little units of life called cells. We all started life as one cell in our mother, and now we're made of tens of trillions of cells. Well, if all of your cells are working the way they're supposed to, you can't be sick. The only way you can be sick is when a large number of cells are malfunctioning. So the way to stay well and the way to get well is to keep your cells functioning as they should, and if they're not, to restore them to normal function. That's what it's all about, restoring health by restoring yourself to normal function. And there's only two causes of disease, deficiency and toxicity. So deficiency is when your cells are not getting everything that they need to function as they should. And toxicity is when they're getting something that is interfering with their metabolic machinery, and so they're not operating as they should. And usually, of course, there's a combination of deficiencies and toxicities that produce most of our diseases. Then there's six pathways to disease, and that's the nutrition pathway, the toxin pathway, the psychological or the mental pathway, the physical, the genetic, and the medical pathway. Those are the six pathways to health, and those are like six superhighways. Say we have two cities, one city is called disease, and the other city is called health, and they're connected by six interstate highways. Well, if you're going toward health on all six interstates, guess where you're going to end up? You're going to end up healthy. Likewise, if you're heading toward disease on all six interstate highways, you're going to end up in disease. So where you are on each of these highways, what direction you're heading in, and how fast you're going is all under your control. And that's what this simple system is all about. It's about taking control so that you move yourself in the right direction toward health on all six pathways. Today, we're going to talk about the nutrition pathway. Nutrition is absolutely fundamental to everything, to our body, to our mind, and even our spirit. Our emotions, even our genetic expression, depends on what we eat. It's all affected by the food that we choose to eat each day. Yogis say that the most important thing in spiritual life, in addition to meditation, is good nutrition. The body is actually a spiritual conductor, and food is a dynamic force that interacts with the physical body at every level, the mind and the spirit as well. What we eat affects every aspect of gene expression, including how we think and how we feel. You know, let's take an individual gene. One gene is capable of producing 2,000 different kinds of proteins. All of these will affect your body in a different way. How does it know which one to produce? you tell it. And one of the ways you tell it is by what you eat. So what you eat affects your gene expression, and your gene expression affects your health. 75% of our health after age 40 is dependent on what we've done to keep our genes healthy, not on the genes themselves, but what we've done to the genes and how they're expressing. We need to protect and repair our genes on a daily basis. We do that with a good diet. Most disease is not the result of faulty genes, but on the diet that we eat, causing the genes to express in the least desirable way. One gene can express in thousands of different ways, depending on the environment inside the cell that you create for that gene. We send signals to the genes, and we tell them what to do. We tell them what proteins to produce. We tell them how to act. The diet that you eat is critical in giving the genes the correct instructions. A chronic shortage of even one nutrient will cause disease. And the average American is chronically short at least several key nutrients. One of the greatest myths today is that you can get all the nutrition you need simply by eating a so-called balanced diet. Well, not so, folks. You can't do that. It isn't happening. More than 100,000 chemical reactions take place in every cell every second of each day, each requiring what in an industrial factory we would call raw materials. In our bodies, we call these raw materials nutrients. Same thing. We're feeding factories with key nutrients, key raw materials that they need to produce the products that the factory is supposed to produce. If even one raw material is missing, you can screw up the whole factory. And that's a very key thing to know. Production will be impaired, and the same is true for our bodies. So in an industrial factory, if we're short one raw material, you can screw up the whole factory. The same thing happens in you. If you're short one nutrient, you can screw up everything. And eventually you will. If you're short one nutrient on a chronic basis, you will get sick. More than 70% of Americans do not consume the recommended daily allowance for zinc. So there's one material, one raw material, one nutrient that Americans are chronically short. More than 70% of us are chronically short zinc. Several times the RDA is needed for good health. So here we are, we're not getting, more than 70% of us are not getting the RDA, and for good health, we need several times the RDA. So what is that telling us? Only a very few percentage of the American population, very small percentage, is getting the zinc that they need on a daily basis. And zinc can, a deficiency of zinc, can cause birth defects, macular degeneration, acne, emotional problems, problems with memory and learning and attention. Zinc deficiency can cause an enlarged prostate. And how many men have enlarged prostates today? And yet we know most of us are short zinc. 75% of us do not get the RDA for magnesium. And again, the RDA is too low. We need several times the RDA. And 90% of the American population is mineral deficient. 90% of us are mineral deficient in at least one mineral. 80% of us do not get the RDA for vitamin B6. More than 90% of us are deficient in omega-3 fatty acids. A vitamin B3 deficiency impairs the absorption of vitamin C. So here, let's just look at one nutrient, just one nutrient, vitamin B3. And let's say you're short just one nutrient, vitamin B3. What's going to happen? Well, that shortage is going to impair your ability to absorb vitamin C. So now you can develop a vitamin C deficiency. And if you have a vitamin C deficiency, that will impair your absorption of iron. And if you have an iron deficiency, this will cause excessive copper absorption. And if you have excessive copper absorption, this will inhibit nickel metabolism, and which in turn adversely affects iron metabolism, and so on and so on. So there you go. You started with one deficiency. Look at the chain reaction that's happening here. And most Americans have at least several chronic deficiencies. So you're beginning to see the chemistry that can happen with these deficiencies. You're going to start to screw up a lot of things. So you have to really work at making sure that you get what you need on a daily basis. Now, if all of these can occur from just one deficiency, just one nutrient, vitamin B3 in this case, just imagine what happens to all of us who have all of these combinations, constant combinations of deficiencies. And that's where most of our disease is coming from, folks, from these combinations of deficiencies. And by the time you get a combination of deficiencies, you have screwed up thousands of things in your body. Vitamin D and vitamin E are both known to affect a large number of genes, genes that regulate the expression of other genes and affect immunity and affect cell-to-cell communication and affect hormone production. And how many of us are deficient in vitamin D and vitamin E? It's an epidemic. So why are we so deficient? Well, depleted soils is one of the major reasons. This is resulting from intensive farming and the use of artificial fertilizers and poor crop rotation practices and premature harvesting. When you harvest something before it's ripe, you don't get the full nutritional development. In fact, the last 24 to 48 hours of ripening are critical to the full nutritional development of the food. And we have to harvest things early so they don't get rotten before they get to you. Well, they don't. When you harvest them, they're going to be low in nutrition because of that. And then we have long transit times to market. And with each passing hour after you harvest something, the nutrition starts to go and go and go. And pretty soon, you've got drastically reduced nutritional quality in your food. And the average American is now only getting a fraction of the nutrition they need for optimal health. But most of us are unaware of this. In the last 50 years, and here to give you a real example, fresh carrots have lost 75% of their magnesium, 48% of their calcium, 46% of their iron, 75% of their copper, and up to 95% of their zinc. And that's just in 50 years, folks. You know, its food is meant to be harvested ripe and consumed immediately thereafter. But today, food is harvested before it's ripe, and so it can be shipped. And this reduces the nutritional content by up to 80%. So harvesting early can reduce the nutritional content by up to 80%. And the time spent in getting to the market further reduces the nutrition, and fresh produce is often 2 weeks old by the time you buy it. Well, there's not much nutrition left after 2 weeks, folks. Some of it has been in storage for a year or more, and then sold as fresh. But nutrients are the food is hearty. It still looks like an apple, even though it's been in storage for a year. It still looks like an orange, but it's not. We buy it thinking that it is when it's not. Nutrients are easily lost and destroyed, and that's what's happening. This process begins very shortly after harvesting. Spinach loses 60% of its folic acid in just 3 days. Vegetables such as asparagus and broccoli and green beans lose 50% of their vitamin C before they even reach the produce counter. The studies on fresh oranges have found that many so-called fresh oranges have been in storage for so long that they contain absolutely no vitamin C whatsoever. In fact, fresh harvested, I had a professor friend of mine that actually did an experiment and found that fresh oranges he bought at the supermarket contained no vitamin C. He went back and found out they had been harvested green 2 years ago and had been artificially colored and now being sold as fresh. No wonder they have no vitamin C. But then mom goes to the store and buys fresh oranges for her family and feels very proud that she's given her family fresh oranges and doesn't realize that they're not fresh and the family is not getting the vitamin C they need. Cooking vegetables, another very, very bad idea. Cooking results in even more losses. Up to 70 to 80% of vitamin C is lost in the cooking process. Up to 96% of vitamin B1, 50% of vitamin B2, up to 72% of folic acid, all lost in the cooking process. Now, cooking disrupts mineral absorption. It makes minerals less able to be absorbed by the body. And the estimated overall loss of nutrients by cooking is 85%. And that's why we tell people, eat foods fresh and uncooked as much as possible, because cooking robs the food of nutrition. Cooked proteins are only 50% bioavailable, so even protein becomes less valuable. Dry oatmeal, for example, is 14% protein. When you cook that oatmeal, only 2% of the protein becomes biologically available to you. So you see what happens. Even protein molecules are damaged in the cooking process. Digesting food is another challenge because most of us don't digest well. Most of us have damaged digestive systems because we've been drinking tap water that's loaded with fluoride and loaded with chlorine, and because we've been taking antibiotics that do permanent damage to your digestive system, and we eat sugar and we take other prescription drugs, and all of these have damaged our digestive systems. And so very important that we understand this, because when we eat cooked food, it becomes much more difficult to digest it when you have a damaged digestive system. So food combining is especially important for us with damaged digestive systems. And in Never Be Sick Again, I have a whole section on food combining so that you combine the proper foods to make them easy to digest. Don't give the body something that's difficult to digest. Give it something that's easy to digest. And an example of something that's difficult is meat and potatoes. You're giving the body a starch and a protein to digest at the same time, and it can't do it very well. So you have to be careful about the foods that you give yourself and how you're combining them. Our digestive systems were not designed to eat what we consider to be a normal diet. Food combining means eating those foods together that require the same chemical environment for their digestion. This approach is dictated by the chemistry of the digestive system, wherein different foods need different enzymes and different conditions for their digestion. Very simply, each type of food requires a different combination of digestive juices to be properly digested. Carbohydrates, such as starches and fruit and sugar, require a more alkaline environment, while proteins require a more acid environment. So whenever you eat foods together that require different environments, you're going to make the digestion very incomplete and very difficult. And so the digestive process becomes compromised and the foods may not be properly digested. And the three guidelines for eating proper diet is as follows. Eat starches, such as grains and starchy vegetables like potatoes and sweet potatoes and corn and legumes and beans and pasta. Eat starches with vegetables, but not with protein. Eat protein with non-starchy vegetables. So you can eat protein with vegetables, but not the starchy vegetables. and eat fruit all by itself. Eat fruit alone. So those are very simple things, very, very simple. Anybody can do it. Eat protein with vegetables, not starchy vegetables. You can eat starches such as grains with starchy vegetables or with other vegetables as well. So the vegetables are usually pretty good. You can eat those with most things, but eat fruit alone because it requires another kind of environment. And so eating a balanced diet is not as easy as it sounds, but if you eat a good diet, supplementation is not necessary. The problem is that not one person I've seen in the last 20 years is eating a good diet. It's almost impossible to do that today. In April of 1998, the National Academy of Sciences, United States National Academy of Sciences, issued a profound statement saying that most people will not get all the vitamins and minerals they need today, even if they eat a good diet with plenty of fresh fruits and vegetables. In a 1999 study in the Journal of the American Nutraceutical Association, they found that only 2.5% of the commonly available nutritional supplement products are both non-toxic and effective. So here we go. What the National Academy of Sciences is saying is that even if you eat a good diet today, you can't get all the nutrients you need. And then the Journal of American Nutraceutical Association is coming along and saying, even if you take supplements, you still won't get what you need because most supplements simply don't have what you need. So it takes a vast amount of care and experience and expertise and cost to create an effective supplement. And the quality of the raw materials used to create almost any product will largely define the quality of the finished product. So any particular vitamin or mineral can have a vastly different biological effect based on its chemical form and the purity and the quality of the raw materials that we use to make the supplement. So vitamin B6, for example, let me tell you about that. Most of the vitamin B6 on the market will actually cause a vitamin B6 deficiency because it contains what we call analog molecules that go to receptor sites, clog the receptor sites, and prevent the real vitamin B6 from being metabolized. And so if you take a lot of this vitamin B6 supplement, you'll actually cause a vitamin B6 deficiency. So is there good vitamin B6 out there that doesn't do this? Absolutely yes, but it has to be very, very pure. Vitamin C, most of the vitamin C on the market is not what you want to be taking, because when they synthesize vitamin C, you get two molecules, and one of them is called D-ascorbate, the other is called L-ascorbate. And these two letters represent different shapes of the same molecule. So it's the same molecule, but a different shape. This is very important in biochemistry because we have enzymes, and enzymes work like keys into locks. And so you have to have the exact molecule fitting into the exact enzyme in order to have them interact. Well, when you're producing molecules that are similar but not the same, you can interfere with a lot of this chemistry. The biologically active molecule with vitamin C is L-ascorbate. Yet most of the vitamin C on the market today is what we call D-L-ascorbate. It's 50% D, 50% L. So you spend a dollar, you're only getting 50 cents worth of value, but it even gets worse than that, by the way. Because if you haven't really properly protected the vitamin C from oxidation, it'll get oxidized, and oxidized vitamin C is a free radical. So a lot of people are taking vitamin C today that's 50% the wrong molecule, and it's partially oxidized, and you're getting free radicals. Vitamin B12, most of the B12 on the market is an artificial molecule that is an unnatural molecule called cyanocobalamin. So look at your vitamin bottle and see what the vitamin B12 is. Better than 90% chance it's going to be cyanocobalamin. And cyanocobalamin is a very poor source of B12. It doesn't process well in the body, and when it does process, it breaks down into cyanide, and so then you get poisoned with the cyanide. But it's just a side effect. So, but you don't want to be doing that. Better formulations will use something called methylcobalamin. And methylcobalamin is what the body uses. It's a biologically active molecule, whereas cyanocobalamin is not. The problem is this. The body very carefully manages how much methylcobalamin is in the blood. So if you take a supplement with methylcobalamin, the body very quickly gets rid of it because it wants to manage what's in the blood. So the half-life, the amount of active life that the methylcobalamin will have in your body is very short. It's in minutes. What I use is something called hydroxycobalamin. It's the perfect solution. And it does everything right. It's very stable. It is easily converted into the biologically active molecule. It just does a whole bunch of things absolutely correct. Wonderful, wonderful. So if it's so good, why doesn't everybody use it? Well, real simple. It costs over $3,000 a pound to buy high-quality hydroxycobalamin. So if you want to learn more about supplements, and you do need to learn more about supplements, you do need to learn more about how to eat a healthy diet, and you do need to learn more about supplements, read my book, Never Be Sick Again. Go to my website, beyondhealth.com, and on beyondhealth.com there's a button that says Free Reports, and there is a free report on there called The Roadmap to Choosing Supplements, and I recommend that everybody read that because we all need supplements today. And if we're going to take them, they should be the right kind of supplements. So you need that roadmap. If you go to a health food store and look at all those vitamins, it's bewildering. You don't know what to choose. And if you ask the clerk, guess what? The clerk doesn't know any more than you do, even though they pretend that they do. But in any event, that's what you want to do. Educate yourself. And know this, that even if you eat a good diet today, you're not going to get what you need. The need has gone up. The need for nutrients is substantially higher today. It's the highest it's ever been in the history of the world. For one thing, we live in an oxidizing environment. And so the need for antioxidants has skyrocketed. And yet the amount of antioxidants in our food has been drastically cut. So we have this enormous gap between the need for antioxidants and the supply of antioxidants in our diet. And if you're exposed to an oxidizing situation, such as if you live in Los Angeles and you're breathing that air with all that ozone in it, and you're using up your antioxidants, and after you've used them up, guess what? You don't have anything left to protect you. You're doing tremendous damage. And that's why everybody who lives in Los Angeles has lung damage, already has lung damage. So we know that this is happening, so you need to supplement. You need to do the best you can. Eat organically grown foods. Grow your own food if you can. Now, there's an excellent study done just last year, and they found that the carrot that you eat today, you've got to eat 4 carrots today to get the same magnesium you got in 1 carrot 50 years ago. You've got to eat up to 20 carrots today to get the same zinc you got in 1 carrot just 50 years ago. So you see what we're up against here. You know, mom's going to the store, she's buying this food, she thinks she's feeding her family well, and the truth is, it isn't happening. And that's the number one reason why we have this enormous epidemic of chronic and degenerative disease. And if we're going to turn this epidemic around, we need to learn how to eat a better diet. We need to get off of the processed foods, get off of all those toxic. When you process a food, the nutrition goes down and we add toxins to it. So what do you know? We know there's only 2 causes of disease, deficiency and toxicity. So when you eat a processed food that you buy at the supermarket, what you're buying is disease. You're buying deficiency and toxicity. So you have to understand that. We need to get back to eating good foods. And the best way to do that at least here in California, where I'm from, is to shop at the local farmer's market. We have a farmer's market year-round, and we're blessed with that. And I know that all you folks out there don't have that kind of blessing. Not all of you do. But do the best that you can to eat fresh foods and uncooked foods, organically grown foods, and then get on a very high-quality supplement program. And there I recommend that you go to beyondhealth.com, that you read that report on choosing supplements and educate yourself. Thank you so much for listening. Be in good health. Now, cooking is also processing. We're talking about processing foods. Get away from processed foods. Cooking is processing. And we get enormous losses. We were never intended to cook our food. Nowhere in nature does anything cook foods. I mean, whales don't build campfires and cook their food. And no one has ever seen a giraffe build a campfire and cook their food. And even apes and monkeys don't cook their food. We're the only people crazy enough to cook food, and we've turned it into an art form. Steaming is best if you insist on cooking food. Steaming is best, and I do cook some food. But a minority. You need to keep it down. Cooking vegetables results in losses of 25% of vitamin C, 70% of B1, 50% of B2, 90% of all sulforaphane in broccoli. Now, sulforaphane is a compound in broccoli that we know helps to prevent and to reverse cancer, and you lose 90% of it when you cook the broccoli. Microwaving, of course, is the worst of all. It's the worst thing you can do, because microwaving generates very unique toxins that are extremely dangerous. And in addition, they wipe out all the nutrients. 97% of the flavonoids in broccoli are destroyed by the microwaving process. So don't microwave food. Don't cook food. If you do want to cook food, don't get it above the temperature of steam, which is 212 degrees. So what I do is I steam vegetables if I'm going to do, or sometimes if I'm going to cook a grain, of course you're cooking the grain in water that you boil so it doesn't get above 212 degrees. So if you insist on cooking, then try and cook at the temperature of water, boiling water, as much as possible. So not to say that all cooked food is forbidden, but minimize it, because Mother Nature, everywhere in Mother Nature, everybody eats raw food, except us. And it's killing us. So, only a side effect. So.
Are you saying that you actually steam the grains, like brown rice and things like that?
No, I don't steam the grains. I put them in water and boil, yeah. But same temperature.
Oh.
Yeah, same temperature. The steam is the same temperature as the boiling water. Eliminate the big four. You know, I love to talk about the big four, and the big four are sugar, processed oils, white flour, and dairy. Those are the major causes of disease in America today, the big four. So if you get the big four out of your life, you will have an enormously powerful, positive impact on your health and your longevity. We just got even sugar out of our lives, we'd probably cut disease in half almost overnight. You know, sugar is a deadly, deadly metabolic poison. It's one of the most dangerous things anyone is exposed to on a daily basis. And when you trace through the chemistry of what happens when you eat sugar, it is so devastating, so unbelievably damaging, that if everybody understood it, you wouldn't want to be in the same room with something that dangerous. Yeah, you wouldn't want to be in the same room with it.
Would you repeat the four again?
The big four: sugar, white flour, processed oils, and dairy. Those are the big four.
Processed oils.
Processed oils, right. And what is a processed oil? Let's take a trip over to the supermarket across the street, go down the oil section, look at all the oils there. Those are processed oils. So every one of those will make you sick. And then if you just step down a ways to where they have the salad dressings are made with the same oils that are in the oil section, so same problem.
And then as you walk around the supermarket, you can pick up cans of soup, or you can pick up baked goods, you can pick up all kinds of things that have those oils in them. So you don't want to be eating any of those oils.
What are those? Any, all oils, like olive, cotton, I mean, all of them?
All of the oils in the supermarket, right.
Pure oils, not the ones in sandwiches.
They're not pure. You can, pure olive oil is very good, but it's extremely difficult to get. So, unless you really know what you're doing, it's hard to get. So, but all of the oils there, soybean oil, corn oil, canola, safflower, sunflower, peanut, all hydrogenated oils, all of these oils will kill you. But again, it's only a side effect. Uh-huh. Nothing to be concerned about. So, they'll give you cancer.
I know you're saying that sugar is very bad, and is that because of the insulin levels that it creates in your body?
Yes. Well, sugar does so many things. I could lecture for 2 days on just what sugar does. But yes, one of the most important things that sugar does is it raises the insulin content of the blood. And there are actually researchers at Harvard Medical School that say if there's a single key to disease, the single key is insulin. And there's a lot of truth to that. So when you make your insulin go up, you're in very, very big trouble. Very big trouble, because you've set off a chain of events that are just devastating. So, sugar is bad stuff. So the big four, well, what happens? You know, sugar. When you metabolize carbohydrates, like sugar and white flour, you require vitamins B1, B2, B3, B5, B6, phosphorus, and magnesium. So you eat some sugar. In order to properly metabolize it in the body, you need all of those B vitamins and magnesium and phosphorus and other things as well. So what happens is, unless you're eating a very, very good diet, if you eat sugar, you will deplete yourself of these critical nutrients. So you become depleted in B5, and that will steal B5 from nerve tissue and muscle tissue. You'll deplete B6. You'll deplete B6 from the brain, and then you can become depressed. Major cause of depression is eating sugar. I've taken people with untreatable depression, got them off of sugar, and they were cured in 2 days. So that just give them some B vitamins and to get them off of the sugar. And there's actually been a number of experiments done on that of teenagers who were untreatable depression. I got them off of the sugar, gave them some B vitamins, and they were totally cured. Phosphorus and magnesium. You steal phosphorus and magnesium from the bones. And so when you eat sugar, you get osteoporosis. Zinc. Here's the thing. Zinc inhibits the absorption of cadmium. Now, cadmium is a bad actor. Wheat has zinc in it, and it has cadmium in it. Well, when you eat wheat, the zinc that's in the wheat prevents the cadmium from being absorbed. When you make white flour, guess what? You get rid of the zinc, but you keep the cadmium. And so now you're being poisoned by the cadmium, and cadmium will poison your kidneys and cause high blood pressure. They'll damage the kidneys and cause high blood pressure. And how many people in our society today have damaged kidneys, have high blood pressure, and this is because of cadmium toxicity from eating the white flour that is part of their problem. So rice, when you make white rice, brown rice, you lose 80% of the B1. And that's why people who ate white rice traditionally had beriberi. White flour has lost 82% of its B1, 67% of its B2, 80% of B3, 83% of B6, 76% of vitamin K, 98% of vitamin E, 86% of manganese, 89% of cobalt, 78% of zinc. These are all losses by making white flour out of wheat.
That's amazing.
Isn't it amazing?
Yeah.
And then they add just a couple of little things back to it, and they call it enriched. No. It's impoverished. Impoverished. Refined carbohydrates have an extremely powerful effect on driving signals that promote fat storage. So it's really the carbohydrates that are causing our epidemic of overweight because they're a powerful effect on fat storage. Well, how do we get the nutrition that we need? We know we need nutrition. How do we get it?
Drink juices with fresh vegetables.
Well, supplementing is essential today, and even the National Academy of Sciences says that. Supplementing bridges the gap because the need for nutrients today is the highest it has ever been in human history. And this is because we're exposed to so many chemicals and so many things in our environment that the body has to deal with. We're forcing the body to deal with things it never had to deal with before. This uses up an enormous number of nutrients. So the need for nutrients is the highest it has ever been, and the availability is constantly going down. So you see, that creates a problem. It creates a problem of malnutrition, and that's why the average American is starving to death on a full stomach. Unfortunately, most supplements are not worth what you pay for them. They are poorly formulated. Almost half of them don't dissolve on time to be of any use to the body. They use cheap and ineffective ingredients that are not biologically correct so that the body can use them. They contain toxins and allergens, and you can't measure the benefits. Every time they do a large-scale epidemiological study of people who are taking vitamins, guess what? They can't find any benefits.
Really?
And a very, very good reason. There are no benefits because they're taking junk that doesn't work. Yet we know from many studies that if we give people vitamins and minerals, they can have a very profound effect on their health, very profound positive effect on their health. But existing products do not. So read the roadmap to choosing supplements. If there's anybody here who has not read the roadmap to choosing supplements, I do have some copies here of the roadmap to choosing supplements, and you need to read these so that you can understand. Let me have somebody pass those down.
Wait, can we have you on this side?
Okay, well, if you were on this side.
Pass some more back, right?
More?
Okay.
Get away from the processed foods. You know, you can get pretty sophisticated about your diet, and I'm certainly pretty sophisticated about my diet, but most people don't want to go there. They just want to live a more normal life, okay? So if you want to just live a more normal life and you want one piece of advice, that one piece of advice is get rid of the processed foods in your diet and eat more fresh foods, more fresh vegetables, more fresh fruits. Get rid of the, you can whole grains, sprouts, seeds, nuts, and all organic if you possibly can. Consume a significant amount of your food raw. I try to eat about 75 to 80% of my diet raw. Now, when I'm home, that's in the 95% plus range. When I'm at home, I eat 95% or more of my diet raw, but I travel a lot, I'm out a lot, and then I have to eat in restaurants, and so the percentage drops. And so I probably average somewhere around 75% raw.
So when you say that when you're home, it's 95% raw, it's mostly vegetables, correct? And nuts?
Fruits and vegetables and nuts and seeds, yes, absolutely, yeah. Sprouts, sprouts are really very, very good food. We need to increase the nutrient density of our foods, the nutrient density. What does that mean? That means if you're going to eat a calorie of food, that you want as much nutrition in that one calorie's worth of food as you can possibly get. That's what we mean by nutrient-dense foods. Now, sugar is the exact opposite. Sugar contains calories and no nutrition. Just calories and no nutrition. So that's the ultimate bad food. Things like broccoli, kale, chard, these types of things are nutrient-dense foods. Every calorie has a lot of nutrition in it. So you want to eat more salads and more nutrient-dense foods. Now, the Hunza, who I talk about in both of my books, these were a group of healthy people that lived in the Himalayas. They lived to an average age of 120 without being sick a single day in their life, so they were healthy. They ate fewer calories than we do, and here these people worked. They actually did work back then. You know, they were farmers, and they lived in the Himalayas, so everywhere they went, they had to go uphill or downhill, or uphill or downhill. And all their farms were on the slopes of the mountains. So they did a lot of exercise. They ate fewer calories than we do, and yet they were never sick because everything they ate was extremely nutrient dense, just loaded with nutrition. So, and the only way we know how to improve longevity, by the way, and the only thing science knows that will definitely improve longevity is to cut your calories, eat fewer calories. And we know that this extends life. And here the Hunzas lived to be an average age of 120. I mean, some of them were dying at 140, 150. And they ate a low-calorie diet, yet it was filled with good nutrition. So increasing the amount of fruits and vegetables in your diet automatically lowers your calories. And in addition, it lowers your weight and lowers your blood pressure. So that's good, and lowers your cholesterol. But here's a problem. Almost half of the vegetables consumed in America today, almost half of the vegetables consumed are potatoes. Potatoes. And white potatoes have very little nutrition in them. That's almost half the vegetables consumed in America are potatoes. And about half of those are consumed as what?
French fries.
Potato chips and French fries, exactly. Two extremely deadly poisons. There you go. We're doing it wrong, and then we're wondering why it isn't working. Americans consume only 5% of their calories from fresh fruits and vegetables. Wow. Only 5% of our calories, and that's why medical costs are skyrocketing. Populations with death rates from chronic diseases, with low death rates from chronic diseases, consume more than 75% of their calories from unrefined plant foods. So there's the epidemiological evidence. It's very, very clear. People who eat low-calorie diets consisting mainly of raw plant foods live long and live healthy. So to be healthy, we must give ourselves everything they need in order to perform the functions that they're supposed to perform. But we're not doing this. So we need to start changing the way we approach this. We need to make different choices regarding the foods that we eat. And you have to educate yourself on what those choices are. And if you do this well, you will be rewarded with health and vitality and freedom from disease and a sharper mind, less chance of disability, and just a higher quality of life all the way around. So to get well and stay well and never be sick again, begin now to get the processed foods out of your life, reduce the amount of cooked foods, introduce more fresh fruits and vegetables, get on a good supplement program, and if you do this, you will give yourselves what they need to function properly. And then, if you do this, your body will communicate, it will self-regulate, it will self-repair, it will keep you biologically young, and it will keep you in good health. And thank you very much for listening, and that's the end of my formal presentation, and I will now take questions from the audience. Yes, sir.
At the beginning, you were talking about deficiencies in minerals and fats. Can you share some citations with the research on that?
Deficiencies of minerals and different, and I don't have citations in my mind, but the literature is filled with them. So the question was citations on and shortages of minerals and vitamins and fatty acids. The literature is filled with them. Just start doing an internet search on it. You'll pick them up very quickly. It's pretty devastating, and the National Academy of Sciences has published extensively on that. The Agriculture Department has published extensively on it. So there's plenty of data out there, very, very available. And the statistics that I was rattling off there all come out of such data, all come out of such studies. Sir?
Raymond, you mentioned earlier on about there's an avocado sitting in your kitchen. Can you walk us through a day of your life, nutrition-wise?
Would I walk you through a day of my life nutrition-wise? Yeah. Oh, dear.
You know, like
that's always
breakfast.
An embarrassing question. You don't want to know how my day goes. I don't have a typical day. My days are so crazy. Some days I don't even eat because I forget. I get up in the morning and there's something in my head and I need to get it down on paper. And I go to the computer, I start writing, and somewhere roughly around midnight, a little light goes on over my head that says, "You forgot to have breakfast." And I've just been sitting there all day working. So I don't have a typical day. This morning I had two organic avocados and an organic hard-boiled egg. That's what I had this morning for breakfast. And then during the day I had an apple for a snack. I had a big salad for dinner. The hard-boiled egg was the only thing that was cooked. And the rest of it was all raw. Sir?
Oh, well, no. So obviously you're not a vegan if you're having hard-boiled eggs.
Right.
What about meat?
What about meat? Well, that's a good question. And there's certainly a lot of argument about eating meat. But I have to tell you that from my studies, I believe that eating some animal protein is maybe not essential, but very wise. I think it's a very wise thing to do. But you have to choose your animal protein carefully, make sure it's not contaminated with poisons. I mean, you can't go to the supermarket and buy beef or chicken or turkey or because it's so contaminated it'll poison you. But there's grass-fed organic beef for sale today. Nothing wrong with that in moderation. And there is high-quality fish, and there is high-quality eggs, and there's so it is entirely possible to get things that are not totally contaminated, and then eat them in moderation. I'll eat a little piece of meat, but I don't have a platter with a piece of roast beef that's falling over the edges. And indeed, the evidence seems to indicate that excessive amounts of animal protein cause cancer and many other diseases. Yet, I often speak to vegans, you know, societies and things like that, and it's hard to find really healthy vegans. Really is. I had a lady come up to me at the last one I spoke at in San Francisco, and she said, "Boy, everything you say is right." She said, "I was a vegan for 7 years," and she said, "I collapsed, and they had to take me to the hospital in an ambulance, and I was so B12 deficient that I almost died."
There was a book called The China Study that came out a few years back.
Right, by Colin Campbell. He's a friend of mine.
Right.
Yeah.
And they were, and they don't seem to have anything positive to say about eating animal protein of any kind, but as I recall, I don't have a right page of it, so.
Well, Colin is now a vegan, by the way, and so we have a little disagreements with each other on that, but it's all in good fun. I think he's just gone too far in the other direction, I'm a member of three medical societies, and I go to medical meetings around the country. And you listen to the talk, you know, at the coffee breaks and the lunches and things like that. And over and over and over again, you get these people saying, you know, "I've never seen a healthy vegan." So if they, you know, if doctors from all over the country are saying the same thing, maybe we should pay attention to their observations. Now, I'm sure you can be a healthy vegan, but it's a little bit difficult, a little bit tricky in how you do that. You got to make sure, for example, you get enough vitamin B12. And so people take B12 supplements. So a vegan would say, I'm going to take a B12 supplement. So they go down to the store, they buy a B12 supplement, and they take it without knowing that it's almost worthless because they just bought junk. I make the highest quality B12 supplement in the world. And there's very good reason for that. It's the chemistry is very tricky, and it's also very expensive. I use something called hydroxycobalamin. High quality hydroxycobalamin costs in excess of $3,000 a pound, and you won't find much of that out there. But it's the only thing that really works.
Dr. Francis, you mentioned high quality fish. Where do you get your high quality fish?
You can go down to the fish markets in San Francisco and get fresh fish. And what you want to do is you want to try and get ocean fish. You don't want to get something that's caught off the coast, you know, coastal fish, because they're going to be the most contaminated. And you absolutely do not want to buy any farmed fish, because that is very contaminated. So that almost eliminates salmon from your diet, unless you really know where the source comes from. Because most salmon today, about 90% of the salmon on the market today, is farmed salmon, and it is toxic. And the New York Times did an expose a couple of years ago. They went around New York City and they purchased wild salmon. And I think they paid like $22 a pound average for wild salmon, and sent it off to laboratories and found that 75% of it was farmed salmon. So it's difficult to get good salmon today.
So where does the best salmon, where does the safest salmon come from?
Well, wild salmon.
What?
Wild salmon, and they do still harvest wild salmon. The problem is that most of the wild salmon people have been put out of business because the farmed salmon people sell the salmon so cheaply, and people don't understand the difference, and so the wild salmon people have been hit very hard economically, and they don't get very much anymore.
Can you tell?
No, you need to send it to a lab, and there are people that give you little tests, but I'm not sure how.
I had a dinner with some friends last night. They had just brought down some salmon from Oregon along with some elk, and just cooking it, you can tell the difference the way it looks.
There you go. Yeah.
Yeah. It says Atlantic salmon on the package. That means it is farmed salmon. By definition, mm-hmm. my understanding. Do you concur with that?
Yes, I think that's pretty accurate.
And if it says wild salmon on the package, it doesn't mean to say it's wild.
That's right. If it says wild salmon on the package, it does not mean it's wild salmon, because, as the New York Times found out, they lie. Yeah.
Yeah, my daughter salmon fishes in Alaska,
uh-huh.
and sends us wild salmon.
Yippee!
I still got mercury. Off the charts from eating so much fish, and I only eat organic, wild, everything.
Uh huh. There you go. Well, you need to get the mercury out. Do you take a lot of vitamin C?
Well, I'm working with a nutritionist. I have a whole thing that I'm doing.
Okay. Well, I hope they're doing the right thing. Any other questions?
How would you get the mercury?
How would you get the mercury out? Well, there are different ways, different approaches, or different things that do it. Chlorella helps get the mercury out. Garlic helps get the mercury out. N-acetylcysteine helps to get mercury out. Vitamin C, zinc, magnesium, all these things help to get the mercury out. Saunas. Variety of different ways. It depends on how much you have in you and how fast you need to get rid of it. There are faster ways that, but they're more aggressive. So I usually prefer to use the slower, less. One question.
Yes, you know those Japanese foot pads that you see advertised on TV.
Oh yes, the foot baths. Uh huh.
Do
you put them on the bottom of your feet, they supposedly take out the metal.
Correct, yeah. It's a scam. Yeah, it's a scam.
The gunk that they see in the
water.
In the water, it comes off of the electrodes. So it's not coming out of your feet.
Well, it's not at the water, it's the pads. But I guess it's the same thing. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. They also have those little toxic
band-aid
pads.
Oh,
I see.
They
yeah.
put on the bottom of your foot.
I see, yeah.
They turn black.
They turn black. Mm-hmm. Well, pretty much the same thing. Pretty much the same thing, yeah. Exactly, in fact, very much the same thing, yeah. Sir?
You do some interesting things in terms of exercise, I believe, in terms of your lifestyle. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, maybe, I don't know which, I like to hike and things like that, but
one,
I do rebounding.
Yeah.
I do rebounding, and rebounding is very important, and most Americans need to do it. And here's why. Here we take our single cell again. I've told you that if you give that cell all of the nutrition it needs, and I've told you that if you keep it free from things that can interfere with its metabolic machinery, that the cell will work properly. Well, that's not completely true. There's one more thing you need to do. You need to move and stretch the cell. And nobody even knew that till about 12 years ago. And it was a paper presented at the annual meeting of the American Thoracic Society, and they were actually studying lung tissue. But what they found was that cells will not operate properly unless they're being moved and stretched. And historically, we didn't have to worry about this because we used to do, you know, four-letter words. You're not supposed to use four-letter words, but we used to do the W word, work. And now we don't do that anymore, so now we have to do the dreaded E word, the exercise. And there's a very good reason for that. You need to move and stretch the cells. This facilitates the delivery of nutrients into the cell, and it also facilitates the expelling of toxins from the cell. Well, there's a way to cheat, and I do it. And it's called rebounding. And a rebounder is a little mini trampoline. It needs to be a special one because if you get a usual one, you'll hurt yourself. But it's a little special mini trampoline. And what you do is you can just gently bounce on it, or you can do calisthenics on it. I mean, I leap up into the air, and I run in place, and I walk in place, and anybody can do this. And the best part of it is that you can do it while you're doing other things. You can watch the TV news while you're bouncing on your rebounder. You can talk on the telephone while you're bouncing on your rebounder, and often people say, "What are you doing?" And I tried to read the newspaper, but that didn't work. Didn't work.
What kind of special rebounder do you get?
Listen to your tapes.
Pardon?
What kind of? You said you have a special rebounder.
Yeah.
Not the ones that you buy in the stores.
Yeah, you can't go to the sporting goods store and buy a rebounder for $50 because you'll hurt yourself. The springs are wrong. The matting is wrong. You'll come to too jarring a stop, and that will hurt your joints and your tissues, and some people have done permanent nerve damage that way. So you don't want to do that.
Can you tell us where you got the rebounder that you talked about?
Go to Beyond Health. We got them.
Oh, you have them?
Yeah, we got them. So very good thing to do, and what it does, and if I had my water balloon right now, I'd show you, but envision a water balloon, and here I am holding the water balloon, and the gravity is pulling on the water and the balloon, and the water wants to puddle at the bottom of the balloon. And now, what if I start doing this to the balloon? Well, it's going to start going sprung, sprung. I was doing this in front of an audience once, and they were all fearful. They thought it was going to break. Well, of course, I tested it, and it's not going to break. But they were all fearful it was going to break. The people in the front row were stepping in. They were afraid it was going to break. But That's what happens. Every cell in your body is doing that when you're rebounding. So the cells in your brain, the cells in your big toe are all doing that. They're all being stretched by the force of gravity. So this is a miracle way to do exercise. 15 minutes worth of rebounding is worth probably running 3 or 5 miles. So that's how powerful this stuff is in terms of what it does for you biologically. Pretty wonderful stuff. And you can do it while you watch television, and it's not like, you know, everybody says, oh, it's too cold out, so I'm not going to, oh, it's too hot out, you know, oh, it's raining, or it's snowing, or I don't feel like going out, I don't want to get dressed, you know. No excuses with the rebounder. You've got it there, and you can use it anytime, even if you use it 5 minutes at a time. Sometimes I'll get up from my computer and just bounce for 5 minutes and sit down again, and you're all refreshed. So, pretty wonderful.
In a week's time, how much time do you put on a rebounder?
Well, I try to put in, I don't measure it, but, you know, I'll perhaps watch the evening news on television for 20, 30 minutes or something, and I'll bounce while I'm watching it. And I don't get to do that every day, but, you know, I do it as often as I possibly can. Yeah?
I've been hearing a lot about ubiquinol, the butin. Why is that supposed to be better, and why, if it's not, why not?
Well, it's good marketing, and what they're saying is that that this is 8 to 10 times better than regular CoQ10. And that is absolutely true. It is better than regular CoQ10, but regular CoQ10 is pretty awful. And so what they're comparing themselves, by comparing themselves to something that doesn't work, theirs is 8 to 10 times better. If you were to take the CoQ10 that Beyond Health has, it would be 8 to 10 times better than ubiquinol. So it depends on what you're measuring against. It's all relative. And so they can truthfully say ours is 8 to 10 times better. And it is. It's just they're comparing it to something that everybody knows doesn't work. So
to continue that, Raymond, the Q10. What's in their Q10 that's missing, or what have they?
Well, it's not missing. It's a different molecule. It's a different molecule. Yeah, and. But we prepare ours in a way that is very unique. We dissolve it in a special oil, and then we make a colloidal suspension out of it, and it becomes very, very extraordinarily highly bioavailable. But it's an expensive process. But the bioavailability is exceptional.
So it's quality.
Again, it's the quality, and that's... you know, that's my passion. That's what I do. And I had to do it for myself, because when I was sick, I was chemically sensitive. All the vitamins I took made me sick. And the slightest amount of impurity would really just blow me away, because when you're that chemically sensitive, very, very small amounts of impurities will devastate you. So I had to seek out things that were extremely pure. And that's how I got to understand the problems with the contamination in most of these vitamin products. Yes?
I'm a little confused with avocados. I think you just used it as an example.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm under the belief that avocados do not ripen on a tree. They only start ripening once you pick them.
Well, no. No.
Not
true? No. No, they all ripen on, you know. I've been in Mexico where people have picked these things off of trees and mangoes and all
other
I mean
fruit, yes, but avocados I thought was just one exception.
No. No. They ripen. And that's where you want them to ripen, because the last 24 to 48 hours of ripening is when you get most of the nutrition in that food. So if you cut out the last 24 to 48 hours of ripening, you've lost up to 80% of the nutrition that that food would normally have. And that's the way we eat our foods. They're all picked, they're all harvested early. So that's why the farmer's market, the local farmer's market, is so wonderful, because you're getting things that have just been harvested. And I'll say, when was this harvested? Because I want to know. I want things that have been the freshest they can be, because with each passing hour, the nutrition is going south. Yeah?
Your diet is so pure. Are you taking your own supplements?
Oh, yes. In large quantities. In large, they've made all the difference for me in my life. And I would not be functioning at the level that I'm functioning at if I weren't on them. It would be impossible. And indeed, I've done several experiments along the way. I'll go off of them. And you know what? I crash.
You mean I can't function at all?
No, but I need naps in the afternoon. Yeah, need naps in the afternoon. I have boundless energy. I mean, I go all night and all day and go for days. I'm just boundless energy. But if I go off of my stuff, I need an afternoon nap to make it through the day. And then at night, I'll be tired when I go to bed. I'm not tired when I go to bed.
So, I mean, I buy vitamins from Whole Foods and, you know, not the health food stores around, but are you saying that the majority of the vitamins in those stores are not?
Are we saying that the majority of the vitamins in those stores are not good for? Yeah, that is precisely what we're saying. Precisely what we're saying.
Well, on what basis can you say that? You haven't actually taken them into a laboratory, have you, and tested each one of them?
Well, there we come in. I'm one of the country's experts in vitamin chemistry, and I've got there the hard way. I've studied it intensely for 20 years, and I'm a consultant to vitamin companies. So at this point in time, I'm very knowledgeable about what works and what doesn't work, and they don't work. First of all, 46% of the multivitamins that you get in the store, 46% of those brands don't dissolve soon enough to be of any use to the body.
Right.
You start with that. Totally useless. You spend a dollar, you get zero value. Nothing.
Wow.
And then it doesn't go too much uphill from there. Most of them are inappropriate forms. Most of them are inappropriately formulated. Most of them contain fillers that interfere with their metabolism. I just looked at a formula the other day somebody wanted me to look at, a multivitamin. It had iodine in it, and it had copper in it. You can't do that. You can't put iodine and copper in a multivitamin, because they're free radical generators and they'll destroy all your antioxidants. So while they're in the pill, they'll destroy your vitamin C and your vitamin E and your vitamin A. And so what are you taking? So you need to know a little bit of chemistry before you venture out. But if you read the roadmap to choosing supplements, you'll learn some of that.
Raymond, did they put ground rock in it also?
Well, yes, they put ground rock in a lot of them. Most of the formulations for, you know, calcium formulations for bones and things are made of calcium carbonate, which is, in this case, not ground up rock, but ground up seashells, with a bioavailability of about 10%. But Healthy America Foundation, by the way, is a nonprofit, and we depend on your donations. And so if you could help out, we'd certainly appreciate it. Yes?
Could you give me your opinion of the vitamin supplement Centrum Silver?
I wouldn't give it to a dog. Do you need any more?
Why?
It's junk.
What is Centrum Silver, which is very much touted?
I know. Total junk.
It's total junk.
Total junk, yeah.
So you're saying it's useless.
Useless,
well,
yes.
The question that goes with that is, how do you know what percentage of what vitamin or how much? You said, I thought before, that there really aren't any tests, so how do people know they can come and get your vitamins, but whether you should take one a day, 2 a day? How do you know which deficiency each person has in their body, you went through all the list of minerals.
Well, you don't know what deficiency is. There are certain things that can be measured. Certainly vitamin D can be measured, iodine can be measured, vitamin B12 can be measured, fatty acids can be measured. There's a lot of things that can be measured, but most of them really can't as a practical matter.
So then how does one know how much to
take? You don't. So what you do is you get the best diet you possibly can, get on the best supplement program you possibly can, and if you do that and get rid of the toxins in your life, you will most likely be okay.
But what is the best? That's what I don't hear yet, and I'm really trying to understand.
The best what?
Beyond Health.
Well, go to Beyond Health if you want the best.
But the amount, that's, I mean, it's your formula, so you feel that
we recommend for people what they should be taking. Based on their level of disease. Now, somebody who has some stage 4 cancer needs to take a lot more than somebody who's in reasonably good health. So it's based on the person's state of health as to what they need.
Do you do an analysis? Do people come to you and make an appointment? And
well, you can fill out a questionnaire. You can fill out a questionnaire and go off of the questionnaire. Yeah.
How do you feel about hair analysis?
Hair analysis can be useful, so I'm not against it, but people, I think, use it incorrectly. It's hard to find deficiencies with it. I would use it for finding toxins, finding lead, finding mercury, finding arsenic. I think it's pretty accurate for that. But when you start getting into nutrient deficiencies and things, the accuracy falls off pretty sharply.
How would you recommend getting heavy metals out of one's system?
Out of your system?
Yeah.
Well, again, depends on what they are and how many there are. But getting on a good diet and getting on a good supplement program and exercising and will help to get them out. We have detoxification. We have certain products that just address detoxification. You want to get your body's detoxification system operating at peak levels. And then you can sauna. Everybody needs to sauna. Every American needs to sauna. They don't know that. You can try and live without it, but you won't succeed. Everyone needs to sauna because the toxins have built up to catastrophic levels in our bodies now. Most of us have levels of toxins in our bodies that are at the same level that cause disease in animals. So we know that these are disease-causing. And they're fat-soluble. They don't come out. The body doesn't have a way to get rid of them because it was never designed to get rid of oil-soluble toxins. It's only since we've lived in the petroleum age that we've had this problem. So we've presented the body with a problem it was never designed to deal with. And so the result is we are bioaccumulating these oil-soluble toxins by the hundreds in our tissues, in our fatty tissues, and at this point there's enough of them that we're causing serious disease. And a sauna is the only way that we know how to reliably get rid of these oil-soluble toxins.
So now, how many minutes in the sauna?
At least an hour.
An hour?
At least an hour. I sauna for an hour and a half twice a week. And that's just for maintenance, just to keep my toxic levels down. Because every moment of every day you're exposed to oil-soluble toxins. You drive on the freeway, you're breathing in oil-soluble toxins. We have a carpet in here that's spewing out oil-soluble toxins by the ton, you know. We're exposed to them all day, every day. You read a newspaper, you get read a magazine, you get oil-soluble toxins. Yeah, it's everywhere, every moment of the day. Your car is loaded with them. You've got to get rid of them. You've got to do maintenance and keep the level down. And I'm certain that one of the reasons that I'm doing so well is that I keep my toxic load down. But I sauna twice a week for an hour and a half, and we have a, an infrared sauna that you can get at Beyond Health that I identified after about 2 years of research that is a very, very, it's the highest quality you can buy.
Well, you mean the lights that you place in our specific room?
No, these are actual boxes, wooden, like big closets, wooden closets, if you will, that you go in and turn the heat up.
What's the advantage of, did you say infrared?
Well, the advantage of the infrared is you can do it at a lower temperature, and a lot of people say, well, I hate saunas. I can't go into a sauna. It's just too awful. Yeah. Well, that's because it's too hot. The infrared sauna operates at a much lower temperature. In fact, where I lie on the bench in my sauna, it's 103, 104 degrees. Well, it can be 103, 104 degrees here in Marin on a hot summer day. But you're still having the effect because of the infrared, whereas in a conventional sauna, they'll often be 140, 150 up at the top. So, yes?
What is the cause for someone, you're talking about sauna, going into a sauna is to perspire, yes?
Mm-hmm.
What does it mean when you don't sweat?
What does it mean when you don't sweat?
No matter how hard you work out, you don't sweat.
Really?
I drink 8 glasses easily of water a day.
Let's put some vitamin C in this thing.
Well, not sure. You'd have to look at a lot of different factors. But it's in the sauna. It's not the sweating that matters anyway.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So.
What is it?
Well, you're not trying to get rid of water.
Well, I thought when you perspire, you get rid of toxins.
Yes, but you get rid of water soluble toxins. The challenge is to get rid of oil soluble toxins. That's the challenge. And you have sweat glands, but you also have oil glands. And if you didn't have oil glands, your skin would dry up and blow away. So the toxins are stored in the oil. So what you want to do is you want to get the oil coming out. And that's why you have to spend a lot of time in the sauna, because you see, the water is temperature dependent. The hotter it gets, the more you sweat. The oil is time dependent. The same amount of oil comes out per unit of time. So that's why I spend an hour and a half. It takes about 20 minutes to warm the skin to where you melt the fat just under the skin. And then once you melt that fat, it starts to ooze out of the oil glands. And then you need some time to ooze enough of it out, and then you need to shower with a good soap. I use Dr. Bronner's soap, and have all those toxins go down the drain. But if you do this on a consistent basis, you'll lose heavy metals, and like mercury, and you will also lose all those oil-soluble toxins, all the flame retardants, and the PCBs and the dioxins and the styrene. I mean, every American has styrene in their body now, you know.
What's that from?
It's from drinking out of styrene cups. And
Isn't that bad
so.
I sauna at 118 degrees at far infrared, and I like it because I sweat. But is there any benefit to keeping it higher, or should I just lower it? And
There's really no benefit to keeping it higher. You can keep it lower if you like it at 118. The question on the table would be this: if keeping it at 118 reduces the amount of time that you can spend in the sauna,
yeah, because I'm only there half an hour.
Well, it takes about 20 minutes just to melt the fat layer under the skin, mm-hmm. So you're getting 10 minutes worth of detoxification.
I see.
Lower the temperature.
What do you think of chelation therapy?
Chelation therapy can be very good. It depends on the circumstances. It can be of course dangerous. Can be of course problematical. So it needs to be done by a practitioner who really knows what they're doing and keeps careful track of the of the patient. And of course, you're pulling out good minerals along with the bad minerals. So you've got to replenish the good minerals. You've got to make sure you're on a good mineral formula to replenish the good minerals. It can be very good. It's a faster way of doing things. A lot of people don't need it. They can do it in a slower way and be just as effective without any of the potential downsides of chelation. But for some people, it can be quite miraculous. I've recommended it for a few people on occasion. I had one man who had a major stroke. He had been confined to a wheelchair for 3 years. And he came to me and he said, "Can you help me?" And I said, "Well, I don't know, but we'll try." So the first thing I did is I sent him down to Southern California to go get some oxygen. So we did hyperbaric oxygen on this man for a week. And very often, hyperbaric oxygen will work and do a very good job. Well, he was there for a week, hyperbaric oxygen every day. It did nothing, zero. So he came back, he's very disappointed, and I was very disappointed, and I felt very embarrassed because I had, you know, recommended it, and the man went down there, spent a ton of money, and got no benefit whatsoever. So then I thought, well, let's try something else. Let's do something drastic like chelation. So I sent him off to a doctor, and he started doing chelation. And just after a few treatments, he could move his little finger. And in about 15 months, he was driving his car. So, and that was a man who'd been in a wheelchair for 3 years with a massive stroke. So it's amazing what you can do, but you have to stick with it and keep trying. But chelation can be very good, but again, you've got to be, it depends on why you're doing it and who's doing it, and is there a slower, better, safer way to do it? And is it urgent that you, you know, do it? Any more? Or are we all wrapped up for tonight?
Yeah.
Well, sounds like we're all wrapped up for tonight. Thank you for coming.